It's Fernanda. Welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I'm going to be answering questions that you asked over on Instagram, so let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so the first question says, tips and tricks for kindergarten. How did you handle small group centers? So I personally love centers. It's like my favorite part of the day. Loved it in kindergarten, love it in first grade. Getting centers up and going can be hard and a little bit stressful and very time consuming. But if you do put that work in, it's gonna be so worth it for the rest of the year. So the way I set up my centers every year is by just kind of having activities, not necessarily academic based activities, but maybe like the group's gonna be playing with Play-Doh, the group's gonna be playing with Legos, whiteboards, and maybe have 5 different activities that kids can already do on their own, and you being one center. The reason I like doing it this way and not just getting started with academics right away is because it's very crucial for your students to be able to get the timing right and transitions right before you get into academics, because otherwise it's gonna be a hot mess. So try having activities like that throughout your classroom and assigning students to those activities first. Have a conversation with your class about what's gonna happen, what you want it to look like, what you want it to sound like, what it is gonna be like, how they're gonna move from place to place, and then practice it. Start off small, maybe with a 5-minute rotation, and then practice those things that you talked about, and then after you do that rotation with a transition, go ahead and talk about what went well and what didn't and what we can work on. And then just keep building up from there. Once students have their timing and transitions right, that's when you can start adding the academic centers. But still do it one at a time, with those being a center with you as a teacher, that way you can teach students how to do the center. Then once everybody's been to your center, where you're introducing a center, go ahead and put that out for students to do on their own, and then introduce another center with you as the teacher. Once you have that structure set up, I love using centers that the structure stays the same, but the content is a thing that changes throughout the year. So students know exactly what they're supposed to be doing year round, just the skills that they're practicing are different. Put a timer on for 5 minutes. Hopefully that answered your question. I will be doing a video on how I do my literacy stations and math stations more in depth once I have them organized, because right now they are a hot mess from last school year. So just give me a month or so. Next question says, will you be teaching a different grade next year? And the answer is no. I'll still be teaching first grade at the same school. However, I will be in a different classroom. So be on the lookout for like classroom setup vlogs, which I'm really excited about because this classroom is a tiny bit bigger and it's not a weird shape. Next question is, what was the hardest part of this year? And this year, this past school year was so hard, especially compared to my first year of teaching. My first year of teaching was a breeze compared to last year, and I think that's a little bit odd because usually your first year of teaching is the hardest, but not for me. And let me tell you why. So my second year of teaching, I went through a lot of changes, life changes and professional changes. As far as life changes, I moved out of my apartment that I was living on my own. I moved out of my first classroom. I switched schools. We bought a house, we got married, we got a dog. So it was a lot of big life changes all like in a short amount of time, which I love. I love the way my life is going right now, but at the moment it was very overwhelming with having those changes as well as professional changes. As far as professional changes, I left my first school, which I loved. I still have a very special place in my heart for that school and those teachers, and I just love that school. So that was really, 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 really hard. I left my dream grade and I went to first grade. Even though I do love first grade, just kindergarten also has a very special place in my heart. And I was very nervous about how I was gonna like first grade. It literally felt like I was having a first year all over again, because I had to adapt to a whole new environment. To make things a little bit more difficult, my school was under renovations for the entire like first month and a half of school, which meant we were not able to use the cafeteria, so students ate in the classroom. I also had to get used to not having specials and me having to teach PE and art and stuff like that. Like, that was a huge learning curve for me because I don't really have like a break during the day besides my lunch break, and then eventually ended up getting a 15-minute break for recess or whatever. But that was really hard to get used to. And I think probably one of the hardest things to also get used to was having my students in my classroom all day long, because it was really hot to go out. It was too hot to go outside. It was like 110 every single day, so we couldn't really go outside much. And then we couldn't go to the cafeteria and use and play inside because we couldn't use it. So being in the same room with the same students for all day long and after school, because after school uses my classroom with my grade level. So my students would be in the classroom from 8 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. So that was really hard. But I don't want to sound like a negative Nancy. It did get better. And I'm sure it's going to be even better next year. Next question is, what is the number one must have for first year teachers? I mean, this is not like a tangible thing that you can go buy at a store. The thing you have to have as a first year teacher, or even as a teacher in general, is a strong support system. You have to find that one person in your building that you can go to and ask for help, or just someone that can hear you out when you're frustrated, someone you can trust. You have to have that person, and if you can't find that person at school, find a friend, your significant other, someone to talk to, because if you don't talk to anyone about your everyday struggles in the classroom, it will get to you. As far as material things, I would definitely suggest getting an electronic doorbell. I love mine, or a clicker, like to switch between slides. I use it all the time. Next question is, how did you know that teaching is what you wanted to do for the rest of your life? I've talked about this before in another Q&A. I didn't know I wanted to become a teacher until the summer I was about to go off to college. I had a conversation with someone that had graduated high school before me. She was studying to be a teacher, and as soon as she told me she was studying to be a teacher, something in my brain just clicked, and that's what I pursued ever since. What really solidified my decision and made me confident in my decision was working with kids in the classroom. Once I got in the classroom, that's when I had that aha moment, like, yes, this is what I want to do. Classroom management and lack of parent involvement in the child's education. So I'm assuming you want to know how to deal with that, or how I deal with that. Parent involvement in my current school compared to my last school is very different. My last school, parents were very much involved. Like 95% of my parents would read every single dojo post I would do. They would check their child's homework folder every single night. I had 6 parent volunteers that would come in every single week. Some of them 3 times a week, some of them twice a week, once a week, but I always had those parents come in. This year, it's completely different. I didn't have any parent volunteers. I think I had 1 parent volunteer one time, and that was it. Homework folders weren't always checked, especially because we have an after-school program, so kids do homework in the after-school program, so I feel like parents might not feel the need to check homework because it's supposed to be done by the time they go home. I don't know. One way I dealt with it is I just kept pushing dojo messages as much as I could. I would tell students to tell their parents, like, hey, check dojo. I would send physical things home in their backpack. One thing that I started doing last year because I saw another teacher do it is, like, when you send like flyers home in a folder and they just keep piling up because no one ever checks them, I started taking them out of the folder and just putting them inside the backpack, because parents had to open the backpack and take out their lunchbox so the papers would be right there for them to see. So that's one thing you can do. I don't know, that's a really hard one. My friend Darren asked a question, and he says, what advice would you give your first year teacher self? I would say take care of yourself. Like, you have to be a priority. My first year teaching itself was not difficult, it was not overwhelming, but my personal life was so overwhelming. I had some very close calls when it comes to family, like tragedies, this word. I had some very close calls, living situations changed like twice. I felt a lot of weight on my shoulders due to this family situation. And that was super hard in order to avoid dealing. And I feel like that really weighed on me. So I would just tell my first year self to take care of yourself, prioritize yourself, find something that makes you happy that is outside of the classroom. Next question says, what obstacles did you face your second year of teaching that you did not experience your first year? Not having as much parent support as I had my first year, that was definitely an obstacle. The biggest one I can think of is not having a grade level team. That was literally the biggest obstacle I think I faced last year. Compared to everything else that I said was hard, not having a grade level team was probably the most difficult part. In my first year of teaching, I was part of a kindergarten team of 12 teachers. I was one of 12 teachers. In that big spectrum I was part of a group of 4 that were in the same pod. So I was so close to those 3 other teachers. I felt so comfortable going to them for help, whether it was about what I was teaching the next day or whether it was about what I was dealing with at home the night before. Like, they always had their door open and I loved having that support, and I'm pretty sure that's a huge reason why my first year of teaching was as successful as it was, is because I had the support of some amazing teachers that I honestly do miss working with because they were so great. So in my current school, I don't have a grade level team. I can always collaborate vertically instead of horizontally, and that was a learning curve. Luckily, I've known the kindergarten teacher since 2013, since I knew I wanted to become a teacher. Her classroom was the first classroom I ever stepped in that I was like, yes, this is the one, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And she's the reason why I wanted to be a kindergarten teacher. Now I'm not a kindergarten teacher anymore, but I still have her support and I love collaborating with her, but I don't have a grade level team, which is so hard sometimes.
Okay guys, so that is where I'm gonna end today's portion of the Q&A. I'm gonna go ahead and post part 2 of the Q&A next week, so be on the lookout for that. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and if you did, please give this video a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already, and I will see you guys in my next video.